Good evening, everyone. We are delighted to be back here this evening for what will be, I think, a real cornucopia of speakers across various very, very different streams. First up is a conversation about the most urgent event that is going to come upon all of us. 2019 is a pivotal year for India. We have elections every 5 years, but this year, it seems that many things are up at stake. It's not just looking at whether a government will stay or a government will go and new parties will come in, but that many contentious issues have come to a boil. And when we vote now, it is going to be a vote on an idea of India. Across the country, in public discourse, the economy is deeply contentious and conversations on the economy are combative. There's a lot of talk about rural distress, the lack of jobs. The entire Northeast is in flames over both the issue of migration, identity, what constitutes citizenship. The new Citizenship Amendment Bill seeks to completely transform the basis and idea of how citizenship is granted and looked at in India. There's been, of course, the latest fiasco in Bengal, where we've had the very unseemly scenario of one government facing off on another government. The CBI clearly being used as intimidation, but the response to that being an impropriety in itself as a chief police officer sits on dharna with the chief minister. All of that really is to say, and then a spate of arrests of intellectuals and public warriors, people who fight for citizens' rights, deemed anti-national, sedition cases filed. So there seems to be a lot of argument over, as I said, the essential idea of India. Underlining all of that is the idea of nationalism, competing ideas of nationalism, and who understands what nationalism is. What are different ways of loving the country, and do we give each other rights of loving it in different ways? To have a peep into those conversations, to help clarify our thoughts on it, we have a wonderful speaker up first. He's, I would say, you know, there are many complimentary ways of describing him, but I'd call him a polymathic upstart, who's radical in his thoughts. Everywhere he goes, he lights little intellectual bombs. He's a professor at OP Jindal University, really at their own peril. And I hope today he brings some of the kind of stimulation for us that he brings every time he speaks in a classroom or in a public platform. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Shiv Visvanathan. That was just the kind of public rhetoric we're surrounded by, which is all false, Shiv. We want you to be very mild, don't say anything problematic, and don't light any intellectual bombs. So let's start with, as I said, the key question that's really facing all of us, which is the idea of nationalism. You've actually looked at it with a lot of scholarship. So one, in the immediate context, would you help define what are the different competing ideas of nationalism? And in your mind, what do you think is a fair definition of nationalism in the Indian context?
See, I think you've got to differentiate between nationalism and the nation state. If you look at nationalism, it was the availability of eccentricity. The Indian national movement actually thought it would rescue the West. We had a different kind of confidence. The nation state is a country that marches in uniform, in conformity with ideas. What we have today is the nation state, not the language of nationalism. Because the language of nationalism was diverse. It was interested actually in preserving languages. One of the first things the nation state was to destroy oral languages. I mean, how many people know that the Indian state destroyed 2,500 oral languages in one day? I think what we have to really look at in this election is simple. It's we have lost the idea of India. And what we're voting for is not Modi, but can we recover the idea of India?
You know, it's interesting that you mentioned that because one of the first speakers we had at Chennai when Algebra started here was G.N. Devi. And he is the greatest chronicler of languages in India. And he spoke of the way we have lost languages. So that you're speaking about, you know, specifically losing diversity in multiple tongues. But can you elaborate a little bit more on this when you say diversity, is it just that we are talking about minorities, plurality in the way we ordinarily understand it? Or looking back to the foundation of this country, when you say that nationalism and the nation state are different, could you just explore that a little bit more?
See, nationalism actually allowed the West to be a part of India. I think this current idea called colonialism is a false one. Indian nationalism actually wanted the variety of West to be a part of India. Someone like Raimundo Panico, one of our greatest philosophers, said, let's keep all the colonies because that way we can understand the West better than the West. We had that confidence. The nation state doesn't have that confidence. It believes in conformity, in uniformity, which is why you have idiot ideas like patriotism and this whole idea that today sedition is a problem. What is sedition? It's basically a suppression of dissent and dissenting imaginations.
You know, so Shiv, in many ways, the idea of dissent against anything, like you said, the nation state. Sorry. Okay. I always do this. I end up usurping the seat which the camera is looking at, whereas we want to look at you. So will you swap seats with me? Okay.
I hope it stops there.
As you keep saying things which are dangerous, I'll come back that side, you know. But Shiv, so to go back to this idea of sedition, what exactly are we looking at again in, the, you know, why has, and this is not just in the Modi regime, you know, even in the earlier regimes, we've had 70 years to do away with the sedition law, but we haven't. Why does it linger on when it was so patently a colonial proposition? Why in a self-confident, independent nation have we not done away with sedition? And would you explore a couple of the sedition cases that have just happened and perhaps lay bare the ludicrousness of it?
First, colonialism didn't end in 47. It continued. Look at the amount of colonial laws we have even now. I think the first thing we got to realize is we haven't exorcised colonialism as an imagination. There were a lot of interesting parts to colonialism. There was an availability of eccentricity. I can't think of, look at the amount of eccentric Englishmen who participated in the Indian national movement, from Alan Octavian Hume to Annie Besant to what have you. That availability of eccentricity is the first thing we lost when we became a nation state. Partly partition was traumatic. So actually, what created the nation state was not the national movement. What created the nation state was the two of the greatest genocides in history, partition and the Bengal famine. I think this is what we forget. The nation state was created by a response to two of the greatest genocides in history. I mean, how many people know that Bengal famine cost us 3.5 million lives? So if you look at the narrative, we make a jump from Gandhi to freedom. But between the two, we had the two greatest genocides in history, which Indians hardly talk about.
But Shiv, that's an unfair kind of statement, I'd say, because if you predicate the idea of even the Indian nation state as flawed as it is, and we're separating that from the constitutional idea of India, that's to make us almost, you know, Atish Tasi recently was talking about Pakistan as existing only as a denial of India. You're bringing us down to that same concept. No. You know, I would say, not to do Pakistan bashing, but I would say that we had, and that's what we're all seeking to protect, a very, very robust idea of the nation state. And perhaps unlike anywhere else in the world, every nation state is built on the idea of a majoritarian language or a majoritarian religion. We are perhaps the only experiment that has not done that. So
we began as an interesting experiment. We have lost the experiment. Okay, take a guess. How many people have been displaced through dams in India? 40 million? You see, if you start counting the varieties of violence in India, from dam development to Manipur to Kashmir, your idea of the nation state hardly exists. And how do we do it? We always say we are better than Pakistan. Could you find a better model of thinking? I think it's time we have a more confident idea of the nation state. At diversity, if we can bring back all the tribal languages, if we can, let me give you a simple example. Let's take Dharampal, a man who worked in Chennai for years. What did he discover? That the first right of citizenship in India in the 16th century was secession. Brilliant. I secede, therefore I am an Indian. I tell you, every time I leave Delhi and come to Chennai, by the time I reach Hyderabad, I have seceded. I don't think, and we think, secession is a creative idea. It's a way of combining the nation state in different ways. You see, today a nation state marches in uniform. The idea of the nation state was anarchic.
Yeah, in fact, Rabindranath Tagore, Gandhi, they all had completely radical ideas of how the nation state should be constructed, not even on the Western model.
And they were anti-nation state. They were nationalists. I mean, look at Tagore. He probably wanted his nationalism to be erotic. Can you think of anyone today who would want an eroticism of the nation state?
Shiv, you were talking about eccentricity. I don't think any of us are really weighing that word enough and understanding the true value of what you're saying. What do you, you know, today the intelligentsia, the middle class perhaps have become more conformist than it is possible to imagine. You know, somebody like Kanhaiya Kumar or like Anand Teltumbe or, you know, Sudha Bhardwaj, they are seen as a danger to the nation state, and the state sees it like that, and there's not enough uproar amongst the Indian middle class to stand up on their behalf. Where do you think the seed of that conformity lies? Is it in our universities? Is it in our schools? Where has that taken root? Why are we not so plural in our thinking anymore?
I think partly because I think over the last 10 years, we destroyed the university. I mean, let's just begin. The first thing the Modi regime did, let's take names. It said any environmental group is seditious by definition because they wanted to make sure there were no objections to development projects, especially in the frontier. I think the first thing you've got to understand is the destruction of the university. The elite doesn't mind because it's exporting its children. But the destruction of the university is, I think, the saddest part of this regime. And the second is the way it looks at knowledge. I can't think of a more cultivated idea of illiteracy as citizenship. I mean, sorry, it's embarrassing that we have a regime which doesn't understand even the history of science in India. We have a great historicity of science. The regime denies it. So if you take it, anything you disagree with, which is seen as the idea of the state, becomes sedition. What did all these people do? Okay, let's first, I'm basically a bit anti-national. I'm partly left, so I have my biases. If you look at, you pick most of these guys, what are the first target of dissent? Naxal. But the Naxals you picked were not Naxalites. They were people within the leftist trade union imagination. I mean, what did Suren Navlaka do? He edited Economic and Political Weekly, one of the great journals of modern social science. And today you say he's responsible for sedition? Okay, close EPW if you have the guts. That would be the final statement. They can't. Because the uproar that would follow internationally of a journal that everyone from Amartya Sen to Pranab Bhardhan wrote would not put the Navlaka case in a different sense. So if you're a trade unionist, you fight for the rights of workers, you're anti-national. If you're a Ram Guha who thinks the BJP is slightly contorted, you're anti-national. So the word anti-national actually is a very flexible term. If I don't like you, you're anti-national. But that is the flexibility that the Modi government is enjoying. You start labeling people as anti-national and then direct a certain kind of violence against them. See, that's the real irony today. That we have a majoritarian system which is where democracy actually threatens democracy. And our regime doesn't understand the irony.
Shiv, you know, when you are explaining this kind of psychology of insecurity, which is seen as a secure nation state, or trying to securitize the nation state, is actually based on a very insecure idea of the country. But what's also bewildering, I think, for the electorate and for anyone who's looking at all of this is that all the weapons that, say, the Mr. Modi's administration is using, those weapons were really created by the Congress government. You know, the sedition, the cow slaughter laws, the FCRA, strengthening the FCRA.
Let's get one thing out. Yeah. There's a colonial continuity between Congress and BJP. I'm not exonerating.
And the left is dead.
Yes, so and the left. Let's be very clear that dissent is against Congress, against the left, and against the current right. If you're a dissenter, you're in trouble with all these three regimes, and we are going to be in trouble for the next few decades. So don't think removing the BJP is going to exonerate dissent. They'll go to jail for a different reason. You know, my professor Rajni Kothari once told me, I was very pleased that someone got elected. He said, stop being an idiot. You'll go to jail regardless of who comes to power. And I think we have to understand that power of dissent. The creativity, the eccentricity is something the current regime can't tolerate. Worse, a lot of the middle class can't tolerate because it looks indisciplined, it looks irreverent. But that is what dissent is. The availability of irreverence, the availability of eccentricity. And in fact, that's how we should define citizenship. I'm different, therefore I am.
Yes. And in fact, that's the gloriousness of the constitution, that it really sets the individual at the heart of Indian democracy, and we seem to be forgetting that. So, you know, you talked about the fact that actually all the political poles are deeply compromised, you know, and to speak against, say, the Modi regime is beyond a point. You know, it's only about the difference in temperature, but otherwise they're all different faces of the same construct.
No, one difference. The Modi regime has been more innovative about violence, whether it's the riot or the mob, than earlier regimes. Congress did start in 84, but 84 was excelled by 2002. And one of the things we really have to confront is the nature of violence in our current day society. I mean, I'll give you a very simple example. I spent 10 years investigating the Gujarat riots. And the simplest thing that stunned me was, one day a woman came to me and said, come and talk to my children. I said, why? She thought I was a psychologist. She said, psychology, anthropology, all the same. Come home. I said, fine. There are two kids. The daughter was 12. The son was 10. And he said, now listen to them. After a while, they started fighting. And the boy said, if you don't listen to me, to the girl, I will do what the Hindus did to the Muslims to you. When rape becomes an ordinary element of democracy, then we have to rethink our society. And rape is becoming too much a part of the everydayness of India. Apart from the decline of citizenship, it's the normalization of rape in India, whether it's in the Northeast, whether it's in Delhi, is something we have to look at. And it's more than a feminist question.
So, you know, since we're talking about citizenship, I mentioned the Citizenship Amendment Bill. Why is it being seen only as a problem of the Northeast? And again, when we're talking about citizenship, in all fairness, would we accept that this is a genuinely complex question, whereas one's reflexive position might be to be humanist, you know, for immigrants who are coming in, refugees who are, you know, fleeing persecution of either climatic persecution or of religious persecution. But for people on the ground who genuinely feel a demographic change, who feel their identity and culture and language are under threat, is that a complex issue, and how would you express it?
The issue has been complicated by electoral politics. I think this is what we have to see. If you go to these areas, there's a certain sense of hospitality, there's a certain sense of openness. But once you play the electoral game, then it becomes a question of interest group politics. I think that's the first thing we have to understand. And anyway, what do you mean by the border? I go to Pakistan, and what do I discover? In the evening, there's a knock on the door. The guy from the hotel comes and says, can you give this to my cousin in Patna? 5 minutes later, someone comes and says, can you give this to my bhatija in Meerut? Goes on through the night. What is this partition you're talking about? I think we have to go back to that question. What is this India you're talking about if you can't redefine the hospitality of citizenship? What made India? The fact we could invite Tibet, that a Dalai Lama could coexist in India? Don't forget another thing. Pakistan is not the biggest Islamic nation. After Indonesia, we are the biggest Islamic nation in the world. We need our notions of civilization to define citizenship. It's not just a secular category. And I think this wider idea of citizenship in terms of knowledge, hospitality, has been lost completely.
So Shiv, I'm just going to push this point a little bit more because, so for us sitting here, not feeling the pressure of populations coming in is different. And as I said, one's intellectually reflexive position is what you're articulating. But in the Northeast, extremely, for instance, it's very interesting that in the Northeast debate, even Conrad Sangma, who's a BJP ally, has broken rank because they don't want immigrants to come in, but they don't want their hostility to immigrants to be defined in religious terms. So they are opposed to the Citizenship Amendment Bill, which wants to give citizenship to Hindu refugees or to Buddhist, Jain, and Parsi refugees, but not to Muslim refugees. So they're fighting that. But they don't want refugees to come in because they are feeling a genuine anxiety about identity. So put yourself in that shoe, and as an intellectual, this is an issue that is across the globe. Many societies are facing this fear of people coming in. Can you help us understand that in a more complex way?
A million Bangladeshis come in and there's no crisis?
No, wait.
That means at that time the leadership had a different kind of attitude, a different kind of hospitality, a different sense of adjustment.
Assam students movement started out of that.
But you see, when you turn question of citizenship into an electoral problem, the distinction between inclusive and exclusive begins. The game of politics is then played electorally. Otherwise, if you go to these communities, they have a tremendous sense of adjustment and hospitality. Why are you talking about the Northeast? Look at the way Chennai actually plays host to hordes of Manipuris. They adjust. You go to any of the vegetable shops, you can talk Oriya or you can talk Manipuri. That's tremendous adjustment. And that openness can be created. It needs political imagination. It also needs a cultural idea of openness. The nation state is destroying it.
So Shiv, maybe we're going to move away after one more question on this. It's just that because I've genuinely found a lot of people who, as you're saying, whose intrinsic instinct is towards hospitality, towards absorption, accommodation, in the Northeast belt, there is anxiety over this. And it would be blind, and I think that's the problem liberals have, where you deny someone else's experience, you deny someone else's anxiety till it starts expressing itself in contorted ways. Why don't we take on that anxiety and try and understand where it is stemming from? When you're talking about Chennai or Tamil Nadu absorbing other parts of India, one, we've arrived at a consensus. The constitution allows all of us to travel to each other's states. Occasionally you have a Kamal Nath or a Bal Thackeray saying no place for Biharis and UPIites, go back. But otherwise, more or less, we accept that we will move into each other's states. But when we're talking about Bangladeshis or the Rohingya Muslims and others coming in great numbers into a particular geographical area, let's acknowledge that anxiety and deal with it. Otherwise, liberals are accused of this kind of,
Let's look at that anxiety. Yeah. So what are you going to do with those 4 million people? Create India's first gulag? Let's look at the alternatives. Anxiety, there is. There is a problem. We need a question of livelihoods. We have to rework the budget for these kind of things. But it is like the invisible wars India has been fighting for years. The refugee is a problem. And the ethics of the refugee will define the future of citizenship. That is the moral challenge of India. It's not a problem of the Northeast. Whether it's Rohingya, Bangladeshi, or many of our own tribal populations, we have to redefine the way we think about economics, democracy, electoral politics. That's the challenge. It's not just a question of adjustment. You adjust, but then you rework your society to allow for that hospitality. We can't be stingy like Europe is to the Syrians, saying, okay, we'll take 1,000 of you. Because by the time I completed my sentence, about a few lakhs have already crossed the frontier. That notion of hospitality is civilizational. The nation state doesn't have the language for it. And as long as you speak the language of the nation state, we're going to have genocide in that area. So the choice is a choice between different kinds of conscience. Do we eliminate them by saying go back, which means they'll die? Do we eliminate them by putting them in a gulag, 4 million of them? Solzhenitsyn will be envious. Or do we say we now create a new kind of economy where we redefine the notion of nature in that area, where we redefine the tribe, we redefine what does it mean to be a citizen in these areas? It could just be an act of residence. But that has to come civilizationally. It can't come from humanitarianism, it can't come from liberals, and it won't come from the nation state, because the nation state has no idea of hospitality.
So, you know, we critiqued one aspect of the Modi regime which seems very problematic, which is of shifting the conversation from nationalism, as you've said, to the nation state, an insecure nation state. On the Congress foot, they have pretty much delegitimized the idea of secularism. Would you unpack for us what has been wrong in the way the Congress over many years has abused the word secularism or in its practice and has made it a word that everyone wants to keep a distance from now? Why has it made it so difficult for this country to claim its secular identity?
Look, between the Congress and the BJP, it became a choice of illiteracies. Sorry, I think when we look back, we have to look at why is that the Congress, with all its great nationalisms and imaginations, eventually emptied secularism out. What we had was a dialogic imagination. You know, I remember Raimundo Panikkar's definition of a citizen. A citizen is a pilgrim who encounters the other to understand himself. I think that civilizational religious idea, which has a certain sense of cosmicity, has to be brought back. What we lack today are the languages for these kind of things. We are speaking a kind of 19th century French and German nationalism. We have no idea of the civilizational possibilities we had. And that means we reinvent our country. This election is actually about all these unstated things. It's not a battle of left and right. Left and right are both impoverished. The question is, can we as citizens, can we as a creative middle class, reinvent our society in new ways? But that means reinventing knowledge, reinventing the university, with a kind of confidence which India seems to have lost. You know, I work in history of science, and one of the things that fascinated me was, you know, Raman booked his Nobel Prize 6 months before it was announced. And it's a fact. He bought his tickets, and he said, I'm getting the Nobel this time. That was the confidence of the national movement. We need that same confidence now to tell Europe, we'll tell you how to handle citizenship. We have to reinvent citizenship. And the reinvention of citizenship will be one of the great new Gandhian traditions. This thought coming in the university, which is why the university has to be suppressed. Lot of the dissent is about new ideas of citizenship, new ideas of accommodation, new ideas of dialogue, which is why this regime, or in fact even the next regime, will make sure the university doesn't survive, except as a tutorial college for certification.
Yeah, no, it's shocking how much one wants efficiency in a university now rather than thinking, you know. There's a real fear of thinking, which is what universities are supposed to be doing. But let me come to another, which was a very interesting development that happened. Recently, Mr. Mohan Bhagwat gave that speech in Vigyan Bhavan, and Mr. Ram Madhav called that the RSS glasnost, you know, because it seemed to re-articulate the idea of Hindutva in some fairly new ways. How would you see that? You know, do you think that that's the genius of India? We were just talking before coming on stage about how Ashish Nandi once said that India is a country of such radical extremes that the genius of this country is that it pulls everything back to the center. So by virtue of being in power, in willy-nilly, you know, the Ram temple has been put on shelf. Mohan Bhagwat gave this speech where he said the idea of Hindutva cannot exist without the idea of Muslims, and the constitution is a consensus document. Very interesting things for an RSS leader to be saying. How would you interpret that?
I think Mohan Bhagwat suffers from historical envy. I think his dream was to pretend he was a Ramakrishna. But Ramakrishna was a religious genius. Bhagwat is a religious bigot. You have to allow for that difference. I'm sorry. He's quaint. He's eccentric. For a minute, I almost wept crocodile tears when I heard it. But crap is crap. Sorry, I think somewhere we have to draw the line critically. He's not, this is not the world parliament of religions. But there was a creativity, there was a movement of pride in India as a civilization. Mohan Bhagwat is not speaking of civilizations, he's speaking of the nation state. Tell him to go and give that as a lecture to the RSS and continue. Sorry, I think it's time we call this bluff. So because then the RSS will have to reread the partition. Are they ready? Then I'm game.
In fact, you know, when you're talking about symbols, it's very interesting, and you're talking about literally suppressing eccentricity, that one of the incidents that has not, again, been discussed enough was this recent one where there was the balloon of the Mahatma Gandhi, yeah. And they actually shot the balloon. You know, it was a little tableau. Now, you can just disregard it, but in a way, it kind of is a metaphor for how you want to absolutely outlaw a certain kind of thinking.
That's what I'm thinking. If that is the Mahasabha's idea of history, let me also point out, if you look at the history, most of our assassins missed the target. You know, we were among the poorest assassins in the world. So I think they don't see the humor of their own thing. It's a spoof of the RSS Mahasabha idea of history. And I think we have to take that. These people are not normal, they're caricatures of themselves. And that is the tragedy. You know, I mean, whether it's Modi trying to get into the Gandhi calendar or the Mahasabha trying to shoot its way into history, it's pathetic. And I think we have to look at that, okay, with a bit of tolerance, because we always tolerate fools. But when fools turn out to be assassins, then I think we have to draw the line.
So Shiv, one last question as we leave is that, would you, you know, liberals have been accused of being as fundamentalist in their approach as the bigots that one supposedly critiques. So the question to you is that, would you talk across the aisle? Would you have a consistent dialogue with the RSS, with the BJP? If you were invited to dialogue with them, would you do it? And secondly, what is your take on the fact that many, right now I think MIT University is starting a campaign because Subramaniam Swamy was invited to speak at the India, you know, the India Union over there. And there's a move to not allow Swamy to come. What is your position on this? You know, are liberals at fault or is that line worth drawing?
Okay, first, I think it's very easy to debate with the RSS or with the communists. I think we have a plural tradition where dialogue is a part of all these traditions. And you know, eventually you come back sometimes with the feeling that you thought you were debating with Marxists. And I remember one Ambedkar saying, Jesus, these guys are a bunch of old Brahmin boys. No, what I'm saying is they're different backgrounds, different mosaics. Second thing, why should you stop Swami, Subramaniam Swamy? I think the best critique of Swamy is to listen to him.
Well, thank you, Shiv. If Swamy will agree, you know, we've already had him here once, but it would be wonderful to have him and you on the same platform.
I'd love it, because I would dine out on it for the next few days.
Okay, I'm sure he'd dine out on it as well, you know. So hopefully that's something we can engineer. Thank you very, very much for enlightening us and for just sparking our brainship. Thank you.